segment this morning, for the last segment this morning before we break for lunch and afternoon activities before dinner, I'm thrilled to introduce you to some very key and devoted faculty that we have here on the Hillside. I will help moderate, just in case there's questions as we get going. But to begin, I'd like to ask them to introduce themselves, their role at the school, and just to demonstrate how much of a family atmosphere there is, everyone can say hi to Brody.
Hi, Brody.
Brody is the son of Jason and Lindsay, and really good friends of my youngest son, Hank. So I'm going to start right here with you, Rich.
Okay. Is this on?
Yep.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Hi. I was told I have to be positive. I will be very positive. My name is Rich Chofka. I am currently the Dean of Students here. I have been here for 25 years, believe it or not. I live in Kyler House. I've been there a long time. I've got two boys off in college this year, Kenyon and Marist, and I've been fortunate to be able to stay in South Kent this long. It's a wonderful place. Thank you.
My name is, I guess you guys can hear me. My name is Craig Carter. I'm originally from Brooklyn, New York. I just finished my first year here on the Hillside. I am the associate basketball coach and equipment manager here, and I couldn't have enjoyed this year anymore. And to the class of 74, thank you for the leftovers. Last night, I will be definitely diving into that when I get home.
Coach Carter is actually taking on a new role next year as the assistant dean of students. His connection with all of our boys, as I watched, you know, part of what I do is you want the right people in the right places. And his willingness and the way he connected with boys across every walk of life, it was obvious from the early weeks, and I just watched throughout the year the way he resonated and the amount of boys that would go to him for guidance. And so I asked him not too long ago if he would take on the role of assistant dean of students.
And I definitely can concur a lot of these stories that you guys are telling. The kids are still doing some wild stuff in the dorm. But, so thank you for keeping that spirit up at these crazy people. But it's been a really great experience. And most people here don't know this, but I think I talked to Brian about it. Then I'll pass it. I'm sorry. I talk too much like my dad. God rest his soul. But I knew this place was really, really special when I brought my grandson here. And he started walking around the Hillside without me. And a lot of the students here embraced him. He's only 12. Well, he actually just turned 12, so he wasn't even 12 when he came up. But and how he felt like this was a place that he may or may not want to go. And when I made the change to leave college basketball and then come here and coach, I did it for my daughter and my grandson. And I had a job opportunity earlier this year, and I gave them the right of first refusal. And my grandson said, no, Pop, I want to come back to South Kent. So, that community and that family atmosphere even resonates with people who don't go to school yet. So, thank you.
Steve Klotz, I am the chaplain, although I seem to do a lot more than just run the chapel. Basically, anything that is not fully academics or athletics, I probably run, like the jobs program, community service, and a lot of other stuff. Been here 30 years, and 30 years of blessing.
Jason LaFave, Director of Admissions. This is my second year here with my wonderful family. Had the opportunity to come here with Brian's basically vision of what this school and the board's vision of what this school could be by bringing it back and getting on the road. So it's been a lot of travel, but I'm happy to say that things are moving in a very positive direction.
My name is Lindsay LaFave. I actually assist students on the other end of their enrollment. Opposite my husband, I'm the director of college counseling. I also assist with academic scheduling, and Jason forgot to mention we are dorm parents in Gilder Hall, which is the largest dorm on campus with 60 boys underneath our care, which is great. It's a great experience for Brody to have that relationship with the boys of our dorm.
The floor is open for questions.
No, we wanted to hear from Brody.
Brody.
So, Brody, when I'm on duty in Gilder, what's your favorite activity to do with the boys in the common room? Can you just say it?
Knee hockey.
So the stories that were told earlier about, you know, our hopes that Lou's Lagoon freezes over in the 2 years that we've been on the hillside, it has yet to do that, but hopefully the third year's the charm, right? So we can get on the lagoon, yeah.
So I will start, and there's no prep that goes into this, but we've had a lot of conversations. I've had a lot of conversations over the last year or so with alumni. They talk about the connection, you know, to the community, the aspect, how do athletics play a role, is our academic program strong? And so I would ask if anyone would want to volunteer just to talk about the community aspect, the connection that the adults have with the boys on the campus, and what that is and what that looks like. I see Father Klotz reaching first.
Well, I care so much about our community life together because that's probably one of the things that's kept me here for 30 years, the close connection between students and faculty and staff and faculty families. And so much of what I do really is about fostering that and making sure it stays strong. We still meet in here for assembly and our chapel services and the jobs program and the sit-down meals that we have in the dining hall. And while these may not be exactly like what they were when some of you were in school here, I think the impact of them is the same or at least similar. Just give us a sense of that we're all in this together, that we all have a role to play in this mission of the school here, to help these young men grow up and, as it says in the mission statement, become thoughtful and engaged citizens. Working together in things like the jobs program, and yes, getting in there and getting dirty, washing dishes, and you'll see a faculty member in there with students, making sure it happens. Going out from here into a community service project to a sense that we as a community need to make a difference in the wider world. All of these things are such a part. I mean, the boys constantly talk about the brotherhood that they have, and that is a central part of it, but it's more than that. It's a sense of being part of a greater thing, which is South Kent School.
Can you tell us a little about your background? Was this your first job
I was not ordained when I came here 30 years ago. I was working for Michael Corrigan, class of 64, and I took our savings for 5 minutes. I was in the Boston area, and I had finished seminary a little bit before, my first stint at seminary a little bit before, and I was looking to do something full-time because my position with Michael, who's about six rows behind you, was part-time, and he said, have you ever thought about school ministry? And of course I had, but I wasn't ordained at the time, and he knew that South Kent was looking for a chaplain to succeed Father Cruz, and here I came, here I've been, and here I'm planning to stay. I grew up in Oak Ridge, Tennessee, actually, but I went to Trinity College in Hartford and been in New England ever since.
Thank you, Father. Lindsay?
I think to add to what Father Klotz said, you know, building a community and having an opportunity to integrate with the boys outside our formal roles. So Brian encouraged us to deliver an experiential learning week. Myself and my colleague decided to plan a Cardinal Bake Off with the expectation that not a lot of boys would be interested in that, but we actually utilized the North Campus and had a great three-day break from our typical academic schedule. And, you know, opportunities like that to allow the boys to interact with us in different ways, I think is very important.
Thank you, Lindsay.
So I'm wondering, I think you mentioned you're sort of reviving the Center for Innovation or the North Campus. Do you have plans for making it a Center of Innovation again? Or I'm just curious about that.
No, yeah, no, that's thoughtful.
It's like such a valuable the problems we face.
How are we, are there plans to re-engage and make that the Center for Innovation again? And I think part of what we want to do is, yes, we have plans, but where schools, and I'm not talking about South Camp, where schools often fall short is they identify an opportunity and they rush to implement it. And when they rush to implement it, they haven't thought about the obstacles or the challenges. And then when they hit those challenges, they quickly say, well, this isn't working, and let's move away. And so, you know, we brought back an alumnus, the Holby family, who runs farms. We talked about this.
Yeah.
And brought them back and talked about the farming sustainability and their operation. I was talking to an alumnus last night from the class of 74, who runs a farm of
Chris
in Cornwall. Yes. Yeah. You know, we've talked about using some of that space for that technology and engineering programming. You know, we brought the kitchen back online this year, where our students were taking some of the coursework and then doing labs within the kitchen. A year ago, those greenhouses were all overgrown. You couldn't open the doors.
I was so thrilled to see it.
And we've cleared those out.
Yeah.
And so what we're doing is over the next couple of years, this isn't going to be a tomorrow thing.
Right.
Because we want to have the right people in the right place to do it the right way.
Yeah.
And as we do this, we can also understand the needs of our boys and those interests. So that, you know, I may think that part A is going to be really awesome.
Yeah.
But in reality, when our boys get here, we say, oh, you know what, actually C is where we need to be focusing some of this energy right now. Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. Gil?
Yeah. This is for our admissions and counseling team.
I'll repeat the question.
This is for our admissions and counseling
team
over here. Okay. These flags, does that mean that one time or another a boy matriculated at this school from each of these, or are they just flags?
This is current students.
What?
So the question was, do these flags represent just flags, or do they represent a boy at some point who came to South Kent, matriculated here? We actually update these flags every year.
So they do represent a boy who is currently enrolled at the school.
Correct. Yep. They represent a boy who is currently enrolled at the school.
Wow. Too much all I can say is, oh my God.
Tom.
Yeah, Brian, you mentioned the school's interest in teaching leadership, but with a greater cohort or older and coming for a more abbreviated time on the hillside, how can those folks take on meaningful roles, mentoring or role modeling for the younger formers when they didn't go through the whole experience? And then the other question I have is this brotherhood. I'm touched when I see the clips on connections, the number of people who talk about brotherhood, but is it within teams, for instance, or do the folks who are on the basketball elite programs, do they mix it up with people who are doing things that are very different?
Well, so the two parts to that question, I think the first one is if we're introducing a leadership program,
and
then how do the older students model that behavior for our younger students if they haven't gone through it? Was that
yes.
The, okay, so that's one, and then number two, the community and the brotherhood, and I have an answer, but I would actually like Coach Carter to respond to that first, about is the brotherhood just within the student, the team, or is it felt throughout the community? So I'm gonna let Coach Carter answer that, I'll give my follow-up, and then I'll answer the question about leadership.
So to answer your question, I think the brotherhood is campus-wide. So of course, obviously the brotherhood would be stronger in each individual team. But I have seen in my first year here, the support that each of our teams give the other teams, right? So for instance, when our team is playing, there's a bunch of hockey guys and soccer guys there. Also at the same time, I really feel like we as coaches have a good bond with one another because we try to pay attention to the challenges that we all have to go through. Like what, you know, Mr. Sullivan was talking about in terms of we have to all help these young men get through this, right? And I know through their recruitment and our recruitment of young men to come here, it takes a special type of person to go through this, as you guys know, you guys lived it, right? And so those young men still need a lot of help and support. And so we are all advisors to a certain extent through with five or six young men here. And most of the guys who I advised this year were not basketball players. And they were coming from all different walks of life. I had a guy from Canada. And so I had one kid who was from Finland who had never been here to the States. And so being able to help mentor those young men and then finding out stuff about hockey that I didn't know, finding out stuff about soccer I had no idea, you know, and then talking with them during formal meals and things of that nature, and then being able to go and cheer them on and then vice versa was eye-opening for me. It was an experience for me that I'll never trade, and I think those young men build bonds. We had a young man who actually is going to Lafayette, and he got close with Nate, who's on the hockey team, and I'm looking at these guys talk about all kinds of things that have nothing to do with basketball and hockey, and it was a great thing to see. I think one of our young men who spoke at Chapel, and I'm forgetting his name right now, he was on the 18U hockey team.
Carson.
Carson's speech was so great because he talked about living here on campus and coming from a small town in Illinois and being able to interact with people from all walks of life that he never would have met had he not come here. And it opened his eyes to how life is led in other places, and he became a stronger person by his own words because of that experience. So I think that brotherhood is campus-wide and has nothing to do with whether or not you're a hockey player or you golf or you're on the cross-country team. I think it's because you're a South Kent student and you bond with people throughout the year.
And just adding that, if you were here this morning, I talked about that boy, that student, Patrick. You know, a perfect example, not an athlete at all, but loved by everybody. And in the spring, we have an intramural basketball league where every student and some faculty participate. They break up into these teams and they have this competition, and they're all cheering for each other. If you walk into the dining hall, tables are mixed. If you walk through the dorms, and you can ask the dorm parents, they find ways to connect. Carson Mitchell's Chapel Talk talked about his 3 years on the hillside, and his first year was COVID. And so they were put into these silos or these cohorts. And so his interaction with other students was non-existent. They lived together, they went to meals together, they had classes, and that was it. His second year, he had made a commitment, I'm gonna step out, but he was afraid to. So he kept himself within the box, which was established the prior year. And he said, well, this year, I said, I have to do this. And so he went in, and he was in Gilder dorm, and around him was 11 boys that he never knew from different countries. And he said it was by far the best year of his life. And it was because he realized that happiness and sort of fulfillment came from getting to know other people with different interests. And I think, you know, when Carson said that, I could see a lot of boys nodding their heads. And so, you know, many schools are still dealing with the fallouts of the pandemic and what schools had to do, or the government told us we had to do, and things. And I think we're finally getting away from that structure that was put into place. Yeah. The other question is, the leadership piece takes time. And so we started with our prefects this year going through these tenets of leadership. We're introducing form programming next year all at once. So there are these tenets that we're going to look at and we're going to evolve to modify for South Kent School, but we have form programming and form meetings and an advisor curriculum that works on these things throughout the year. And so it's gonna take 1-2 years to develop that type of curriculum. Again, it's one of these things where be patient, do it the right way, instead of just trying to throw a lot of mud against the wall and see what sticks. Yeah. Peter.
Yeah, so I have a question for Richard. If you could just give us some of the highlights of the academic program and where you're headed and what some of the opportunities opportunities are and approaches. It's not too easy to summarize quickly, but.
That might be better for Lindsay.
Yeah, I'm not the person to address that, but I do want to just say one thing about the form programs. We anticipated this idea that kids are going to gravitate to a reference group. Obviously, they do that, and for the most part, it's been sports for a long time. And that's built into the form programs. That's the intent of the form programs, is to give them an identity outside of their sport, so they can start to work together with kids from different places. And I think that was partially successful this year, and I think it'll be a big success next year. But that's part of the intent of the form program, to try to address that.
In regards to our students' academic interests, I think we have to continually look at that and evaluate it each year. But for this year, you know, robotics, engineering, and we're actually offering a very timely class on election and predictions, and which we think is very important for students to understand as we head in into the fall. But I think it's just, you know, Jason can probably speak to what he's been told on the road, but I think it's just listening and evaluating what we're doing in the classroom, and are we making those appropriate connections for their post-secondary goals.
Yeah, and I think this goes back to the question that was just brought up as well. I mean, some of the other part of what my job is to get more awareness of our school and what we're doing here. And there is a focus on third and fourth forms. And so, I don't know if you shared this, Brian, but our fourth form class is bigger than last year, right? So we are getting younger. But on the road, we hear about, you know, technology, finance, economics, right? We hear about engineering. And bringing this back, I remember last fall, two falls ago, my first year, when I would come back off the road and Brian and I would sit down, I said, this is what we need. And we did it, and we're doing it. And it's gonna take time to get it to where it needs to be. But you can see it. I mean, up 55% enrollment to date compared to last year, up 45% in applications on January 15th compared to last year. So, I mean, it's moving in the right direction. And yeah, the community is wonderful. I mean, I think the other piece, too, just to touch on what Father brought up, the jobs program. I had a family in last week. It breaks down all socioeconomic, you know, differences, right? So everyone's the same. Right, regardless of if you're, you know, if your grandfather was the leader in Bermuda, or, you know, if you're coming from like Patrick from Liberia, and your mother is going around door to door washing clothes to feed her family. So I think all these kids are so super close because we're so small, and it's one of the benefits of our school, and I use that so much and so often, just like the jobs program, right, just like Chapel.
And I also think it's important that at South Kent School, and what I think we do really well that may not occur at other schools, is our diversified academic offerings, to be able to expose our students to entrepreneurship, marketing, you know, some of these terms that we throw out, but do students really understand what an economics course is, you know, before they get to college? So, you know, having those opportunities to offer those classes as a standard course, as a Syracuse University dual enrollment course, is so important. And I think it highlights to the colleges that they're applying to that they're a multifaceted student. They're just not an athlete. They, you know, so showing those interests and being able to highlight, you know, those on their college applications is extremely important.
Thank you. Yes.
I'll leave it for you to address this to, but I'm wondering how important an attribute it is that South Kent's an all-boys school, and whether there's pressure to change that. And the second part of my question, prompted in part by when my son was in high school, he came out gay, and I'm wondering how a gay boy would feel about applying to South Kent and how welcome it would be in this environment, and how do you guys deal with that?
Two great questions, and I'll start with the first answer about the boys. I'll let others, and then I'll address the second part of your question. All boys school. I I believe that I have witnessed, now I've been at co-ed schools, and that the people talk about, well, there's no girls, it's not a distraction. But the truth is at an all-boys school, boys can be their authentic self. And what do I mean by that? If you look at the chapel, the nativity play, I went to it, I worked at an Episcopal school where we stood in chapel, and not one student would sing. Why? Well, the boys don't want to sing in front of the girls. They're uncomfortable. It's about a hierarchical and a coolness image. If you go into our chapel, and there are some songs, there are some hymns where they belt it out. But in the nativity play, where the boys get dressed up and they walk down and do solos down there, you wouldn't see that. You don't see that. And so I really believe, from a natural development perspective, being an all-boys school, boys are more comfortable. They take chances that they won't take. And it's why, like we were talking earlier about getting back a theater program. And it was one of the experiences that I had in high school which sort of changed the way I looked at things. Do you all want to add to the boys? Yeah.
Everything you're saying is right in terms of them being comfortable being who they are and being out there and singing in chapel. I think there's another thing going on. It might be said that there used to be a strong argument for a girls' school as a place for girls to find their voice, as you mentioned earlier. I think nowadays you hear that there's a crisis in boys. And you look at things like in public schools, who are the academic leaders now? And it's usually girls. Boys are faltering, and there's a whole range of issues and speculation on why that is. Being here at South Kent, tied to what Brian was saying, they're freer to find their academic voice too, I believe, because it is a boys' school. If anything, there's a stronger argument now for a boys' school than there was 50 years ago.
Thank you.
And
is there support? Student does come out? I mean,
yes.
The student body is...
No, so one of the things that we brought to campus this year is, if you look at it, we brought a group called The Call to Men. All right? And the gentleman's name is Ted Bunch. And he works, his organization, he started his career helping with battered women. Okay? And that was where he started his career. And then he started working with the NFL and Major League Baseball and the NHL to teach the men about what it means to actually be a man. And then he's working with Division I colleges. And a parent brought this to me, and Coach Chilius did, and we had them present. And it was about getting rid of, and he basically started off by saying, I need to apologize because of the culture that has been handed down through generations of what is acceptable behavior for a man. And kids kind of looking around. And basic question that he asked the press is, if you're walking down the street and you see a man hit a woman, and you go up and you say, what are you doing? What's the response? It's none of your business. He said, there's a sense of ownership, of authority or dominance. Talking about how we treat people, talking about how we treat students who are struggling with sexual identity, and you go around the room. And I think one of the things we're focused on right now is teaching our boys that we're human beings, and how we treat one another is so critical and important. And everyone in the room, even though they may not, has someone in their family who is most likely struggling with something. And how would you feel if this was your brother or your sister? And what does that mean? And Ted did an amazing, amazing job, and he's a curriculum that goes along with it. Beyond that, we're talking with our counselors, our mental health counselors, about how do we create an environment that is welcoming to everybody, regardless of that? And how do we take that and build that into an advisor program? Because if we can address the school as a whole, anytime you bring an assembly together, half the kids stop listening. We know that. But how do we want to break this off now into our smaller group advisor program.
and have an intentional curriculum that allows boys in a smaller group to have open dialogue and conversations. And sometimes those are difficult conversations, but they're conversations that have to take place. And so I would like to think that our boys are accepting, but I also recognize that when you bring in students from all over the world, there are cultural beliefs and differences amongst our student body, and it's our responsibility to have those conversations in smaller groups where we can have open dialogue. I hope I answered the question, sir. Any? Yes.
Community service, can you talk about that? Because volunteerism and giving back.
Yes. Yep. And it's
somebody
such a
mentioned
thing.
It, but we don't know what it is.
Yeah. Father Klotz wants this one.
Yeah, well, I spent a lot of time making sure it happens. I have an expectation that every student takes part in community service. I don't know if you all have heard, and it might be a horror of horrors for you to learn this, we do not have Saturday morning classes anymore. Shocking, I know, but highly necessary, because when you had groups such as teams traveling on Saturday morning, if you were a Saturday morning teacher, it was very difficult to keep the students up to pace. I think it's wonderful because it frees up the boys to do community service on Saturday mornings. Not every Saturday, because of course they're often traveling, but I do have events happening every Saturday supporting a lot of things. Like if you've been in the town of Kent this weekend and you've gone past the Kent Memorial Library and there's a book sale going on, we set that up, we take it down. For them, we just set it up in the spring, take it down in the fall. They say they're great at pricing books, but most of the volunteers are quite elderly, so we're good at carrying the books. Visiting the Morningstar Nursing Home every Saturday, visiting with the residents there, playing bingo. Beyond that, I take students 2 Sundays a month to church soup kitchens, one at the Episcopal Cathedral in Hartford, and then to a program called Chapel on the Green, which is at Trinity Episcopal Church in New Haven. Begins with an outdoor worship service with whoever wants to come. I mean, the idea of that program is to take the word and to take a meal to people where they are on the streets. Eye-opening experiences for the students to see this. I hope I get most students on at least 3 or 4 trips during the course of the year. Not everybody can work it out to go on one of the soup kitchen trips, but I think of 155, 160 kids last year, I got 110 over to Hartford or New Haven to see that the wide range of things people can do to make a difference in their communities. I particularly like, of course, the church soup kitchens, because I want them to see faith in action. Unfortunately, so often faith in the news, Christian faith is often given a bad name by people think, oh, it's all about this and it's all about that. Well, you see these dedicated people, members of this church, just down there making a difference. 3 or 4 members of the cathedral congregation every year every week are there helping out. One person who's often there is, in fact, a South Kent alumnus, Andy May, from the, I think his class of 82 or so, which almost always joins us when we're at the cathedral in Hartford. So it's an awful lot, and I think beyond that, I mean, quite frankly, even things like the jobs program in their own way, well, have to serve the community you're part of. We serve this community too. So I hope that helps.
I do want to be aware of the time. It's almost 12:45, lunch is going. So let's take one more question. People will be around all afternoon and tonight at dinner, so they are always available to take individual questions. But let's just have one more, and I want to make sure you get down to lunch. Yes?
Do you regularly, or do you have the appetite to regularly have alums who are successful in a variety of disciplines come in and speak? And do you want to be, here's what you will experience, here's what you have to do to get there?
So the question, and I will point to one fine gentleman, young gentleman who came in this year to see some classes. Hope you don't mind if I pick on you, Paul. But the question was, do we engage with our alumni who have experience to come back and talk to our students, correct? Am I saying that?
Specifically about professional goals.
Yeah. And so this is something we've talked about a lot. And Paul came up in December, I believe, visited some classes, and we're looking at ways, I mean, Paul has a very distinguished career, but looking at ways for him to sort of serve as an expert voice in some of the material that we're doing. And those are things that we absolutely, when we talk about connecting our alumni with our student base, that's it.
What sort of material was it? What's your field?
National security and strategic planning.
Oh, okay.
Pretty cool stuff. And as we move forward over the summer, and we develop the website and the South Kent Alumni Connect, there's another plug for it. It's going to give us an opportunity to understand where our alumni are and what they've done, and to reach out to them and say, hey, we have a class that's talking about this. We would love if you could give us a day, come back on Zoom call to talk about your experience, or these are things you should be thinking about, et cetera. We're also looking at, even an expansion from our college counseling program of like, what do you want to do if you know? Not many kids do. But if you do, and what do you need to do to get there? So that's really what we're trying to do. And I think the more we can connect our alumni, their stories, their expertise into our classes or with our students, the stronger we will be. So with that, I just want to say thank you, and thank you to the panelists for coming.